Hello and welcome for another presentation in your World Regional Geography course. This time we're going to introduce the realm of South Asia. So let's begin. South Asia is the result from the Indian plate colliding with the Eurasian plate. Although this happened 70 million years ago, it has certainly given the Earth its tallest mountain range and point, Mount Everest, at over 29,000 feet. Due to the continued convergence, with a movement of at least 5 millimeters per year, earthquakes are not just common, but very destructive in this realm. Speaking of other natural disasters, monsoons are a seasonal reversal of winds that bring incredible amounts of precipitation. Although the rivers and streams become very full, the water is often not clean or drinkable. Parts of India can receive up to 6 feet of rain per season. Looking at this diagram on the right-hand side, we can see that the monsoonal seasons between June and September. We also see that it's a reversal of winds, hot air rising, causing this great amount of precipitation. But what I did mention was that often the water is not clean. They find that in most of the areas within and around India, Bangladesh, and stuff like that, the groundwater is even contaminated to a depth of 1,000 feet. Which includes, but is not limited to, just arsenic. So arsenic poisoning is a very common attribute within Asia. Moving forward, India has had a long history of peoples going back to 3300 BC, the Indus Valley Bronze Age time. The Mauryan Empire was between 322 and 185 BC and was the most extensive and powerful empires in India. Many empires would exist and leave their power on the landscape with features such as the Taj Mahal, the Red Fort in Lahore, and the Agra Fort. Colonialism did occur by Britain and it lasted between 1857 to 1947. South Asia's growing population has exceedingly high demands on agricultural production. The amount of area available for food production is divided by population may be more of a helpful indicator of population distribution than the total population density itself. So as an example, looking at the diagram on the right-hand side, we can see the population over the last, since 1800, so over 200 years, of both China and India. And we can see that for a long time, even up until the late 1990s, that China was the leading population. Well, but enter now into current time and going forward, it's estimated and has been seen that India has an exceeding population, that their rate of population is growing beyond the unfortunately, the death rate, right? So you have this balance of how many people are coming in versus how many people are going out, and they are exceeding that population volume, which is also turned into concerns of limitation of childbirth, which is we've observed in China with the how many children are you allowed to have, and by putting government regulations on stuff like that. There were some interesting conversations about India and within their caste system and more in the religious peripheral in how when a family member dies, who's allowed to bury them, and one of the cultural aspects, it was you had to have a son that would bury you, and so a lot of families, if they were having additional females, that they would either have to abort or have to find a way to conceive a son. Now, looking at the population density and relief, so again, side-by-side images, population density on the left-hand side, raised relief on the right, so we can see some of the tallest mountain ranges right there, right, you know, along Nepal and Bhutan or whatever. But looking at the population itself, we see, again, where are populations most dense? They're, in this case, they're more dense along the peripheral, along the waterways, until you get up into right beneath Nepal. Well, why would that be? Well, you have to imagine, again, talking about just water. We know that agriculture is of dire importance to this realm. So people live near where they work. And so since there's still a lot of people that are dealing with agriculture, we find that the density of population is very heavy in the north and also for trade, business, and industry down to the south. But we do see, again, correlations with relief, resources, and where the density of the population will live. Now, there are some peripheral states of this realm of South Asia. The Punjab is a fertile agricultural region with ample fresh water and a high population density located between the border of India and Pakistan. the king of Kashmir, conflict is about location and control of water rather than labor and resources. So there is no great demand for labor and resources, because without the resource of water alone, you cannot have agriculture, you cannot have industry, and you cannot have a population that can survive and grow. The Kingdom of Bhutan is a small country without much industry or high-tech corporate involvement. Forestry and agriculture are the main economic activities, which account for about 60% of the population workforce. The Kingdom of Nepal, about 80% of those people work the land in a region that is suffering from severe deforestation and, as a result, soil erosion. Because of the deforestation and lack of trees to retain and hold that soil, the monsoonal rains will wash that fertile top layer, usually the O horizon or the A, which is the top soil itself, will actually wash it away from the mountain fields into the valleys. Sri Lanka, cinnamon is native to the island and has been cultivated since colonial times as its most important export still to this day. But on top of that, coconut, coffee, and teas are also very important financial exports. The Maldives, a group of low-lying islands that consist of about 26 atolls, which atolls themselves are the remnants of oceanic volcanoes that had ever completely eroded and left behind just the rim, which encompass a territory of about 115 square miles. Within the atolls, about 1,200 smaller islands, of which about 200 are inhabited by people. Now, we'll also include Pakistan and Bangladesh. So both Pakistan and Bangladesh have very large populations that are increasing rapidly. Both countries have agriculturally based economies. Rural to urban shift is occurring at an ever-increasing rate in both those countries, and population growth places an incredible heavy tax on natural resources and social services. The political units within Pakistan include the four main provinces, Punjab, Baluchistan, Sindh, and the Khyber. Bangladesh is a low-lying country in which the dominant river, actually the Ganges in particular, flow into the Bay of Bengal. Flooding is a major environmental concern that has devastated the country on a regular basis, but we also find that flooding can also be important in areas in the release of nutrients. But again, dealing with the monsoonal rains, sometimes the rate of erosion is exceeding that of deposition, and so it does become quite troublesome. So let's look specifically at India for a moment. So Britain exploited India by extending railroad lines from the three main port cities into the hinterlands to transport materials from the interior back to the port for export. The Indian Railroad is one of the largest rail networks on earth. Although it does not connect major cities, it was used to move resources for exportation, which is really interesting. So there's this, one of the largest railways in the world is observed here, and it wasn't designed for people to bring people together in transportation. It was specifically to exploit the exports. Rural and urban life within India subcontinent varies according to wealth and opportunity. While concentrated in general, the population in rural areas is discontinuous and spread quite thinly. In urban areas, the populations are very concentrated. So again, that rural to urban shift is very prominent. India's economy continues to rapidly expand and have a tremendous impact on the world economy itself. In spite of the size of the economy, India's population has a low average per capita income. Approximately one-fourth of all people in India are living below poverty. Now, speaking of economics, cinema makes up a very large portion of the entertainment sector and part of its financial sector. While India's growing vehicle manufacturing is actually moving ahead progressively. Recently, the Indian government has created national parks, wildlife sanctuaries, and game reserves to help protect rare, threatened, or endangered species. The diagram that I chose for the right is showing some of the language distribution. I just thought it would be an interesting way for you to then, if you want to look at this and then shoot back into population densities, do we find that there are certain populations that are more prone to speak this parent language, lingua, versus others? Which brings us into religion. Hinduism is one of the most the world's oldest major religion still being practiced today. Its origin can be traced back to ancient Vedic civilizations in India approximately 3,000 plus years ago. The religion is found mainly in India and has the third highest number of believers in any religion in the world. Each Hindu branch has its own level of castes, and thousands of sub-levels can be established over time within those. In Hinduism, the basic system originated of the five main caste levels. So what's interesting about the caste level is it's born into. It has nothing to do with how hard you work, how not hard you work, things like that. It's a system that you're born into. So you're born into being a priest or a teacher, born into being a warrior or a merchant or a laborer or what's considered the untouchables or outcasts. Buddhism spread across India's subcontinent about the 6th century BC and became the religion's most dominant religion within 1500 years. All branches of Buddhism teach nonviolence, honesty, selflessness, tolerance, and moral living. Buddhism holds to the four noble truths of the Eightfold Path, or the middle way to enlightenment, which I did include on the right-hand side if you'd like to see a little bit more about the four noble truths. Just to kind of, since they're there, in case you're not reading it, the Four Noble Truths, that suffering exists, suffering arises from the attachment to desires, suffering ceases when the desire ceases, and freedom from suffering is possible by practicing the Eightfold Path, which is down below, you know, view right, view intention, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right mindfulness, and right concentration, all done through ethical conduct and meditation. So let's test it real quick. So again, I have provided you four questions that you will be seeing on an exam later on. So let's go through these. So what is the caste system based on? Question number two, most of the population in Nepal work in what industry? Question number three, India is known for its wide disparity between its poor and rich areas. The poor area is often referred to as. And question four, what physical feature forms a natural boundary between South Asia and East Asia? So before you unlock these answers, don't forget to like the video, comment below if you've got a question, and don't forget, if you haven't, subscribe. Question one, the caste system itself is based off of birth. Most of the population in Nepal work in agriculture. India is known for its wide disparity, but the poor area is often referred to as the rural area. And then what physical features? The Himalayas. I hope this was helpful. Don't forget to check out the next video, and we'll talk soon.